Welcome to the 13th Bar. It's Pete Hatchell and
JR
is in the house. Well, it's your house, so I'm kind of hoping that you're in the house. Are you in the house?
Well, we're both in the house.
Both in the house.
First time for a while.
Oh, man, tell me about it. It's been a long time coming, people. We're in Melbourne, Australia, and to say that we have been locked down would be a terrible understatement.
We're still in a form of lockdown, but it was a harsh lockdown for like 4 months.
4 months. The lockdown was so bad, I've even grown a man bun.
Yes, it was bad because you grew that horrible, horrible man bun.
Whatever. It's a man bun. What are you going to do?
The good thing is, like, I don't want you to cut it before Christmas because now I know what to get you for Christmas. Like, curlers, alligator clips, shampoo and conditioner, because clearly with hair that long, you must be going through it like a dog, man.
So much. So much right now.
And it's not like we're traveling to for work, so we're not able to grab all the free shampoo and conditioner from the hotels we stay at.
I never use that crap anyway. It's all shit.
I did for the little hair that I have. And whenever I have guests, I'm like, I'm not going to buy. Look, why would I buy shampoo and conditioner for guests? Like, get stuffed.
Exactly. No, much, no. You know? That's why you give them the hotel stuff. That's why you give them the hotel stuff. No, we've been in a crazy form of lockdown, and I have been essentially in my small apartment for the last 4 months, 5 months.
In my small apartment. Yeah.
It's small.
I don't know many people that are like, I live in a giant apartment.
I had a big apartment. Tennyson Street was a big apartment. That was a big apartment.
I would just call that an apartment. I wouldn't say it's big. Like, that's just generically what I would expect the size of an apartment to be.
Ergo, I live in a small apartment now. and I have let my hair grow. It looks atrocious. It looks like, yeah, and I currently look like Ozzy Osbourne from the No More Tears album.
Yoko Ono.
He says Yoko Ono, and he's the only one that says Yoko Ono. I look like Ozzy Osbourne from No More Tears.
Wait. The only one. I'm sure if you talk to more people my age, they'll be Yoko Ono.
No, most people are your age that I work with or others associate with. And they all said Ozzy Osbourne.
No, I'd count your daughter because she actually knows who Ozzy Osbourne is.
No, she looks more like Ozzy Osbourne than anybody else.
Sharon!
I'm living in a $6 million shit house.
A dog peed on the carpet. Why should have been let outside? Why was it inside peeing on the carpet?
All these dogs, man, driving me fucking crazy. My favorite line from that show is and always will be, I love you all more than life itself, but you're all fucking mad.
Like, coming from Aussie, you're like, yes, that actually carries a lot of weight.
Yep. It does carry a lot of weight.
Yep.
And for the very first time in 5 months-ish, JR and I went out and...
drank too much.
Way too much.
That's why my voice sounds like, you know... what was it? You know, can't get enough of your love, babe. That's why my voice sounds so goddamn low. Because when I'm hungover, my voice seems to just drop another octave.
Which is why I'm not looking forward to what we're going to do later on. But we'll get JR to explain that later.
I did say that. As soon as I bought them out, thing out that you'll hear about in a sec, I was like, oh, it's probably not the best time to do this at this point.
Definitely not the best time.
Having said that, I tried some good gin last night. It was nice.
You enjoyed yourself with that gin last night.
The sampler was good. Yeah, I'm glad that we then left the building because I could still be there now drinking gin, to be honest.
Yeah, it was a very good night. We went down to one of our favourite places, not only to go to and drink, but also to go to and play. We actually play there in our band, Chicago Dime, and on occasion Groove 67.
You can name the joint, it's fine.
772.
772 Wine Bar.
Wine Bar in Caulfield on Glen Huntly Road, corner of Glen Huntly and Hawthorne Road. In Caulfield, and it is fantastic. Our very, very, very good friend Cheryl owns the bar. And we have an awesome time there. Awesome time.
It's great because you're allowed to BYO food. which is brilliant.
And it's a really cool location as well. It's pretty central. You can get...
it's public transport. It's great.
Easy as. It's actually outside of a tram stop. Like, you can get off the tram stop and it's right there.
51? Yeah.
Yeah, 51.
I'm trying to do all the marketing stuff. I used to say the stop. Stop 51 on Route 67. That's
Route
the
67,
one.
Stop 51.
That's the one.
You get off the tram and it's right there and all you got to do is just cross the street. And it's fantastic.
Yeah, and there's a 7-Eleven around the corner when it closes. And yep, you need to get some water before you can jump in the Uber. Done.
Or a coffee.
Yeah, sure, whatever.
I do the coffee. We've been through this. I do the coffee.
It's horrible coffee, though.
Oh, it,
and
true.
After too much drinking, I wouldn't be able to stomach that. I'd just go the water. I'd go the water.
Not that Jamie drinks a lot. Excuse me.
Well, I haven't for months now because I've been stuck in a bloody house.
It was really nice to be out again. And nice to see people out again. Nice to see people out and about.
It was nice to know that Melburnians haven't changed.
So, what are we up to today?
Well, I thought that before we'd get into the topic, I just wanted to let everyone know that here we are talking about like bands and stuff like
that.
You can get some 13th Bar podcast merchandise. There's a t-shirt.
There's a t-shirt now.
There's a t-shirt. So,
happy days.
Have a look at the link in the description.
Yep.
It'll be there no matter what streaming, however you're listening to us.
Beautiful.
You'll be there. So, you know, if you feel like getting a 13th Bar...
Looks good.
...t-shirt, you know, I like it. So,
I like it. Looks good. I had no input in it, so I can actually say it looks good without actually being biased in it all. So, no, it looks really good. Go down to the link below. It'll take you to the shop and, you know, get yourself a 13th Bar t-shirt. Can you please comment below? We really would like to, you know, respond to whatever people have to say.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, we want to hear your opinion and we want to make fun of it.
I don't want to make fun of it. I want to respond to it while I make fun of it.
Right.
In that response.
So today, all right, so today, since it's the first time that we're able to meet face to face, I thought, heck, you know, let's have a game. Let's have a bit of fun since we've been just doing video stuff for a while.
Yep.
And the game is called Music Shots.
Yes.
I think it was at the start of this year, I think that thing went on Facebook where, you know, there was that thing where you had to put...
Top 10 albums.
Yeah, top 10 albums you love in no particular order.
Exactly.
I took Pete's top 10 albums that he named at the start of the year.
That are all awesome.
And my 10.
That aren't really.
And I've put them in the Brains Trust. They're in the Brains Trust.
The Brains Trust.
They're in the Brains Trust hat. And what we're going to do is we're going to draw them out. And you have to guess the year it was released, that album was released. And if you get it correct, you get 2 points.
Yep.
If you're in the right decade, you get 1 point.
Yep.
And if you completely get it wrong, you have to have a shot of hashtag not a sponsor. Sponsor, not a sponsor.
Hashtag.
Kaiju Crush Beer.
That sounds awful, and I'm really unhappy that we're doing shots today.
And the only reason that I chose that one is because one of the places that we're doing gigs at, the Inkerman Hotel, has this on tap, and they had a promo when we did a gig there New Year's Eve. And I didn't get to try it, so I thought, well, heck, you know, let's try Kaiju. I think it's Australian, too, which is kind of good. So
that's cool.
It is.
It's got a nice can.
I don't know what it tastes like. But
it's very SpongeBob can.
And tropical pale ale, so I don't know what I'm expecting there. But
looks like a can from SpongeBob cartoon.
Which I find peculiar, because Kaiju, that's the like Godzilla, right?
I have no idea.
Godzilla, the big Japanese monsters, they're Kaiju, right?
I know, I have no idea.
I don't know. Well, you know, please tell us in the comments. This is a bad day to do it because... We're kind of hungover.
Oh, God almighty.
Oh, that smells like a fruity pale ale, mate.
Oh, that's...
I'm glad it's only a shot and not scull a can.
Oh, man. I've got to drive after this, so I've got to get a lot of this right.
That's okay. Yes, a lot of it right. And, like, I don't think you'll get through the whole can because that's a pretty big...
I'm not going to get through the whole can.
Like, you know, I mean, like, even if you get it wrong, I mean, like, it's only a shot glass, for Christ's sake.
Yeah.
You got your special music shot... With the music note on there. Thank you.
What have I got?
Thank you, Shorty, for... Same thing.
Oh, nice.
Thank you, Shorty, for giving me these ones many years ago.
They're good.
Do you want to draw the name out the first?
The weirdest thing is that this hat actually does say Brains Trust, which I'm really...
That's my Hewlett-Packard hat. Oh, you dropped a name.
So am I picking one out?
Am I picking one out first?
Yes, you're picking one out. Don't look in the hat. You're not allowed to look.
All right, let's have a look.
Pick one, you know, because hopefully you'll get, well, my ones.
Well, this is the one that we didn't think on. Oh, what do we got here?
What's the first one? What's it say?
It is one for you. One
well,
for you.
Well, it's your one, so.
Rock Swings, Paul Anka.
Oh, so this is for you. So you have to pick.
I have to pick.
Well, whichever one you draw out,
yep.
You have to say it.
Okay.
And if it's, you know, if it's lucky, it's one of the ones that you, one of the songs you, albums you picked, so you know it.
Aha, now unluckily,
you've pulled out one of mine. And to be honest, like, I think I can remember when it was released, but it's not up to me. It's, oh, actually, no, I think we said we were both going to do it, didn't we?
Oh, no. The pick is going to do it.
We said
the pick is going
yeah,
to do it.
The pick is going to do it. All right. So go.
So I'm going to use sort of like a method of elimination.
A method of elimination.
So I'm going to go the decade first because I'm pretty sure I'm not going to get the year. But the decade I'm going to go is the 70s.
It's Rock Swings, right?
Rock Swings, Paul Anka.
I need to keep score here.
Cool, keep score. I think it's going to be the 70s. And
okay.
I'm going to go 1974.
Okay.
And then you can tell me about the album, Jay.
Wow. Okay. So we've got Google here cuz I think I know what year this was released.
Okay.
To be honest.
Cool.
I think you're wrong.
Okay.
Because I remember I just finished university.
Jeez.
When this came out. So I'm pretty sure this is 2005.
You're kidding me.
Nope. I'm pretty sure it's 2005.
Wow.
I mean, because he did like swing versions of Black Hole Sun, Eye of the Tiger. Well, Black Hole Sun's on there. So I know that already puts it past the 70s.
Oh, no. If Black Hole Sun's on there, I'm gone.
Well, too bad. So what year did you say?
74.
Oh, geez, mate. I think you may have to have a shot. I think it's 2005. All right, good old Wikipedia. Released May 31st, 2005.
All right. Oh, that is not a favorite beer of mine. Wow, that's really bad. Actually, it's not all that bad. I think we had such a big night last night.
He means bad in a good way, Kaiju. Please sponsor us.
No, it's...
It's bad, you know it. It's good.
It's good. It's great. It's fantastic, I'm telling you. Yes. All right, your turn.
My turn. All right.
This is going to be interesting.
I'm going to look. Okay. You took the Paul Anka one out, right?
Yeah, I took the Paul Anka one out.
I'm kind of hoping I get one of mine. I just don't want one of yours. Well, actually, your ones are probably easy.
Mine's going to be easy.
All right. Can I have the hat back?
Hat back.
All right. What has the Brains Trust doled up to me? Ah, bugger.
But what did you get?
Rising Force. Engve Malmsteen.
We couldn't have written this any better.
Damn. The sad thing is that when I was typing all of these out, because I had a look at your Facebook wall and pulled them all, because it just has the picture. I just had Rising Force Engve, because I knew how to spell Engve. I'm like, how the hell do you... What was his surname again? I had to look online to see what his surname was and how to spell it.
Yeah.
So you honestly think I'm going to get the year? I didn't even know his last name.
And by the way, it's Engve J. Malmsteen.
Oh, whatever.
Engve Johan Malmsteen.
It's every single letter in the alphabet, Malmsteen.
There you go.
Oh, God. And as I said, like when I pulled all of yours, my running joke to you after I told you I'd pull them all was that I don't think any of yours were released after 1982.
No, they were.
Released 1986. Either way, by the time I turned 10, single album you'd listed in your top 10, they were all before I turned 10.
Probably.
I think they were.
Actually, no. I think there was a couple after.
Right, yeah, hang on, couple right. after. What is it? Rising Force. I'm just going
to... Yep.
...track. And I'm Pete, you're currently on zero, so...
Zero?
All right. So...
What about you?
I've got everything working for me at the moment because you're on zero, so I can beat this. Okay. Rising Force. Engve Malmsteen. Okay, Engve. Oh,
I actually know the answer to this. Sort of.
Well, look, it's Engvay, actually. So that probably would be post-80s. I'm going to say... Because I remember when Alan's like, you know, we used to see Engvay there, and that was the noughties.
Yep.
Could be a late 80s. But I'm thinking... Look, I'm going to go in 90s. And okay. I'm going to say 1996.
You're 10 years off.
Oh, it's 86, isn't it? Yep. Damn! Damn!
Check it for me, but I'm pretty sure
Why
it's 86.
Why am I not surprised? Once again, my running gag. I was 4 years old. No wonder I don't know it.
And now that we've done this, we're going to just give you a couple of words on both albums. But what was it?
1984. 84. So I was still in diapers and... Being potty trained.
Exactly.
Shorty had... My sister hadn't even been born when this was released. Aww.
Take that shot. Take it. Take it like a man.
Take it like a... Engvay.
That was so poetic.
It is fruity, isn't it?
Oh, it's, mate, it's a lot. It's a lot. It's fantastic, Kaiju. We love your beer.
It's nice and dry.
Oh, no, it's like really actually, all jokes aside, it's actually really quite good.
I like the end, that the smell and the first whack that it gets you in the mouth. Like
it punches you and then it leaves you alone.
Because we like a Pilsner and a drier beer.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And we're hungover. Yeah. So we probably, I reckon, if today was like a 32 degrees or higher,
yeah,
that would be really refreshing.
Totally.
In the summertime, that would be really great.
Totally.
Just so, not for this.
Give me 2 minutes on Paul Anka, Rock Swings.
Rock Swings. Well, I mean, well, I kind of said. So we don't know who Paul Anka is, you know. Of course, the guy who wrote My Way.
Yep. No.
As well as a bunch of other songs, everything. Of course, everything. But so in, yeah, like in 2005, we would have recorded it before then, he released that album Rock Swings and literally took a bunch of rock tunes. Like it's got Eye of the Tiger on it. Black Hole Sun. I can't remember what else is on. It's got a whole bunch of other ones on it off the top of my head. And did jazz versions of them. But all he took from the old songs, all he took from the originals was the lyrics.
Okay.
So he wrote whole new songs.
Oh, wow.
New arrangements, but just took the lyrics. So it's Eye of the Tiger lyrics, but the song sounds nothing like Eye of the Tiger. Different chord progression, different everything. With everything. So even Black Hole Sun. Just took the lyrics of Black Hole Sun, whole new song. You know, so it's almost really, like you look back at it and go, like, is he a smart man or maybe not so smart? Because they spent all that time writing brand new original songs.
But putting old lyrics on
And
it.
Then just went, oh, I can't be, like, I'm not inspired enough to write more lyrics or write, or maybe write some good lyrics. I know, we'll just take lyrics from other songs. I'll put them over the top of this. And, you know, it'll be a popular album because we'll call it Rock Swings.
Yeah,
you know?
I'm going to have to listen to that. It's a very, there are very few of these obscure albums that you like that I would even bother to listen to. I'm going to listen to that one.
That's really cool. And, of course, like, it was like when I was at uni, I'd finished uni, it was a hit. Like the big bands that I was playing in pretty much the year this came out.
Yeah.
Yeah, or every big band all of a sudden wanted to play these arrangements. Like, okay. I've got the arrangement of Eye of the Tiger off Rock Swings in... The library, right here.
Oh, fantastic.
And I've got one of the other ones he did too. I can't remember what the other one is. God. But every band did them. Yeah. Every big band at that point was like... And I remember I went to Marimbula and for like the next... I think the last time I went to Marimbula, even just a couple of years ago, there was a big band that was playing it. And they were like, oh, you know, because it's different. Not many big bands did them. In the city they did, like the top five big bands kind of did, but a lot of the other ones didn't. You know, it's not like it's built for school bands. And I introduced a lot of my mates... like brass band mates to it. And it's really good. Like if you know those original songs, you laugh because you know the lyrics. All of a sudden when you hear Eye of the Tiger, you know, it's the Eye of the Tiger, you're like, I know all the lyrics, but it's a completely different melody, different song, everything. I think it's one of his best. It's very, very cool.
Okay. You know? Okay.
And tell me, what is Rising Force?
Rising Force is, if you want to blame anybody for all the neoclassical heavy metal guitar super fast thing, you blame this album.
Right.
That's the reason. That's the reality.
But I can see here it's his first studio album.
So yeah, it's his first studio album. He was actually in a couple of bands before this, one of them being Alcatraz, but this is where he essentially put all of that neoclassical Bach, Paganini stuff through an electric guitar, through a big Marshall, and he played really, really fast, and it just started that whole genre.
I just realized this has the only Yngwie song that I know. Black Star. I didn't realize that was the first track on this album.
Yeah. So this is...
That's the only Yngwie song I know.
This album really created a genre of guitar playing, and I love it. I loved it when it first came out. I actually had... Yngwie's a pretty big influence on me as far as the classical element of my playing, which is very, very minute. But it definitely comes from this album and you know, that whole... and I think the best way to explain it is, for someone who doesn't know or doesn't understand it, is Jamie's sister, Shorty, you know, asked me about these shredding guitarists. And I said, well, just imagine a solo violinist. That's essentially what they are, just of the modern age. And this is exactly what that is, you know. It's the super fast, super classical, you know, very, very minor orientated music. And it could fit really well over a rock band as well as over an orchestra, which he did.
Okay. All right. Next one. Yep. Your choice.
All right.
Pull another name out of the brain's trust. That hat's going to have to be in everything now.
Oh, no.
I'm going to have to incorporate it somehow.
Oh, I can't believe I picked this.
What'd you pick? Come on.
Transformers the movie. Various.
So, Transformers the movie soundtrack. You pulled one of mine, mate. One of my albums I love. Come on. All right. See, this should be pretty easy because this is attached to a movie. So the decade's going to be easy for you.
Okay, that's so it is the new movie. It is the movie, the Michael Bay movie.
No. It's Transformers the movie. Remember what Transformers the movie was?
No.
Oh, well, good. Maybe you might get it wrong. Cool.
Crap. Just to give you a heads up, Jamie picks obscure stuff. His top 10 favorite albums are crazy as batshit.
It's unlike yours that were pretty much... all guitarists between 10 years.
I have no idea because I don't even know what the movie is. Is it a cartoon movie?
Look, I can't give you hints, man.
Okay. Screw it. 77. There you go.
77?
77.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you. So it is the cartoon movie.
Great.
And think I was born in 82. So you honestly think it's 77? So it was the 80s, I can tell. I think it was actually 86.
86?
I'll have to check that. I'm going to take a shot. But it's definitely the 80s, so you're going to have to take another shot.
Take a shot.
Of course. Oh, yeah. Oh, I don't care about the Michael Bay one. August 8,
1986. There you go. There you go.
Zero for you again. Now, if you're wondering why it was on there, is because number one, as a kid, like, that was my cartoon. You know, it still is to this day. I still love Transformers and all the cartoons. And Transformers the movie, the music for that, you know, very hair metal-ish with some of the bands that are on there. You know, it's got like, that's the one that's got, You Got the Touch, Stan Bush.
Oh, man.
That's on that one, you know. Dare to Be Stupid, Weird Al Yankovic. Love it. Line, Transformers, so bad hair metal. But all the incidental orchestral music that's on there is not orchestral. It's by Vince LaCola.
Who's that again?
Well, he's kind of a synth
guy. Yes.
It's orchestral stuff, but it's electronic stuff, and I love that kind of music. So that's why it's popular for me. Like, you know, Vince LaCola. I love all of Vince's stuff, like, you know. And you're lucky. So that's the official soundtrack that doesn't have a lot of Vince on it. It's mainly got the artists on it.
Yeah.
I have another one that was released Japan only, which is just all of Vince's music, just the background music.
Oh, wow.
And that's incredible. But you know, I won't bore you with that one.
Your turn.
All right. God, I can't believe we're picking each other's.
I know, this is...
And this is not set up. Oops.
Unlike everything that the Top Key does. I didn't say that.
All right, okay. Here's another... There we go. All right, here we go. Dun, 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 dun. We are opening, and it says... Yes! Maybe.
What did you get?
I got one of my ones.
Okay.
Headhunters, Herbie Hancock.
Yeah.
That's the album that... It's only had four songs, like Chameleon and Watermelon Man.
So you should know this pretty easy. You should piss this in.
Yeah, I know, but I can't remember the year. Was it the 70s or was it the late 60s? Oh, my God. I'm going to say the 60s because it's still kind of electronica, free lovage type stuff. And I'm going to say 1968.
Let's see how well Jamie knows his own music.
I know the songs on it. I know the album really well. It's known as one of the greatest albums of all time.
You said 1968.
Why did I do this after I drank so much? Oh, crap.
What was it? 72?
1973.
This!
Oh. Damn you! $5 says the original Watermelon Man was probably 68. The jazz one, no, my luck. 73.
I was pretty sure it was going to be 70s too. That one I actually really believed it was 70s.
Oh, man. I mean, I'm not going to wax on about that one too much. I said it's... You look.
What, it's a fantastic album.
But it's in the top 10 jazz albums of all time. You know, the likes with, you know, that has like Kind of Blue and all that kind of stuff in it. Headhunters is in there. It's in the top 10 albums, jazz albums of all time.
Did Jaco Pastorius play on that?
No.
No?
No. I should have known it was then too. I just finished reading his biography. God damn it.
Too bad. Okay, I've got a new one. Hopefully it's one of mine, but I doubt it. Knowing my luck, it's probably going to be like something stupid.
We are batting.
It is one of mine.
We are batting at a zero average here. I'm not liking it.
Okay, it is one of mine. And it is one of my favorite bands, one of my favorite albums, Level 42, World Machine.
All right, come on.
Jeez, when did World Machine come out?
And people are probably listening to this going like, geez, why don't these guys cheat and like cram or study beforehand and try and memorize the years?
We were drunk.
And to be honest, I did think I'd memorized all my years, but I'm hungover.
I'm really torn here. World Machine.
Come on. We need a guess.
It's going to be either late 80s or early 90s.
I've never heard of this one, so I can't help you.
Level 42, World Machine. Inside this world machine.
My guess is it's, you know, what, guitar-heavy band again?
No, it's actually Mark King, bass-heavy band.
Oh, okay. Right,
bass-heavy.
Right.
It was that sort of like a pop, funk, almost some ska, reggae kind of, but really modern.
Well, I can see why you're tossing up between, like, you know, that late 80s, early 90s, and if it's that.
Yeah, I'm going to say 88.
Ooh, okay.
I'm going to say 88. Could be wrong, but it's. I'm going to say 80s.
What was it again?
World Machine.
So what year did you say?
88.
Oh, that's recorded. That's not released. When was it released? Hang on, let me check. I was going to say it's recorded in 1985.
Okay.
But nah,
it'll be 86-ish.
October 85.
October 85. Okay. Well, I don't have to take a shot. I got the decade right.
That's right. So you got 1 point.
One point.
Pete has moved up in the ranks. All right, come on.
Give me the
brain's trust.
Really important album for any bass player and any songwriter. Incredible song. World Machine itself is a fantastic song.
Never heard of it.
Amazing.
For the guy who went to university, never heard of it.
It is great.
Studied a music degree, never heard of it.
And every bass player would kill to have the right hand that Mark does. Every bass player.
Well, except Jaco Pastorius.
No, he'd kill to have the same, seriously, killer right hand.
All right, here we go. crap.
Oh, what did we get?
Diary of a Madman. Ozzy Osbourne.
Yes.
I have no clue, man.
See, if you'd listened to me in all these drunken nights, you'd actually learn something and you would actually know the answer to this.
See, but those things don't work. You can't listen on a drunken night. Like, just those saying, things don't work.
I'm just saying.
Well, actually, I take it back. I do listen on drunken nights.
Not to me.
I do. I do listen. I don't retain any of it, exactly. But I do listen.
Ozzy Osbourne, Diary of a Madman. Great album. Great album.
Oh, I'm just going to have to pull the shot. Oh, I'm just going to take the shot before I even guess the year, because there's no way I'm going to get it correct.
okay. No? What's the decade, you reckon?
I reckon it's 80s.
Okay.
Because in 70s, he was still Black Sabbath. It wasn't Ozzy Osbourne.
Mm.
So I'm thinking 80s. And it's Ozzy. Oh, geez, actually. Oh, it could be early 90s, actually, when I was in primary school. Actually, I take it back. I'm going to go 1991.
Okay, you get that. That's it.
Madman, right?
Yep, Madman.
All right. Yep. Yeah. 1991.
You're 10 years off.
Kidding me. November 7, 1981. I still wasn't even born yet. See, I was thinking of see, it was reissued in 1995 on CD. That's what I was thinking of. I was clearly thinking of when it was reissued on CD.
Take your shot like a man. Diary of Madman, one of the most important albums in heavy metal. It is an amazing album.
That beer's getting nicer now. I'm getting acclimatized to it.
really, really good album. Has some of the best songs in metal by far. It still stands up today. I actually listened to it before I came over, believe it or not. Just
yeah, I don't recognize any of the songs on here.
Crazy Train. Crazy Train. No, that was on the previous album.
But then again, I don't recognize a lot of Ozzy Osbourne stuff, so.
Jeez. Super important album, guys. Super important album.
All right, keep going. What do you got?
All right, here we go. This is actually reasonably entertaining for me. I don't care about you guys in the audience. For me, it's actually reasonably entertaining.
It stinks.
Oh, my God.
All right, what'd you get?
Orleans and Claiborne Trombone Shorty.
Yes.
Seriously, it's almost like a Top Gear episode, this thing. Like, we couldn't write it any better. Like, for the love of... And I love Trombone Shorty, I really do. Two of the best gigs I've been to, straight up.
Yeah, let's hope. Well, he was supposed to come back out for Byron Bay Blues Fest this year before, you know.
Before the COVID. Shit hit the fan. Decades, 2010s, 2012.
Wow, really? Okay. I don't think it was, because this is the album that Dynamite comes from. It's his first one. So
I was thinking it was an earlier one.
I think 2010 might be a bit late. I think it's like 2005 again, actually, to be honest.
Really?
Because this is the first one.
I just didn't think he was that old.
Well, he's not, but he did this is his first album from when he was young. Hang on a sec. Oh, jeez. And of course, there's no Wikipedia section for it, is there? Oh, here it is. Release date, 2005.
Damn it.
Well, it wasn't even his first release. It was the first release that I heard him on. I've discovered that he released another album before that, to be honest, when he was still in like high school. But this is the one that has like Dynamite.
What a great
stuff.
Beer. What a great beer.
This beer rocks.
It's a great beer, I tell you.
I will say, like, yeah.
It's actually getting to be really quite nice.
If you can find Orleans and Claiborne, I mean, I had to buy it secondhand from a dude in New Orleans because...
Wow.
It's literally out of print because it's on some smaller... I think Treme Records, a smaller label in New Orleans. So, and it's not on streaming. It doesn't have any of that stuff on streaming.
Wow.
Because it's early stuff. So, okay. I recommend it. I love it. It's great. Yeah. It's one of his better ones. All right. What have I got? Here you go.
Come on, universe, be kind to me. Be kind to me, universe.
Papa needs a new, some more points.
I'm leading, by the way, aren't I?
Yeah, I know. Like I said, like...
with one
top
point.
Top 10 albums we love, and at the moment, it's 1 point. Aha! Thank you. The gods have smiled upon me.
Damn it!
Star Wars, John Williams.
Oh, come on. I could even do that.
What? Hey, the deal was pick it from the Facebook top 10.
Oh, my Lord. What was
it?
I'll even
give you... It's not my fault that Star Wars, John Williams is in my top 10.
Can you confirm? Because Jamie already knows this answer, hands down. Yes, it's not even a question. Was it 1978?
No, it was 1977.
77, there you go.
Because the movie came out, of course, Memorial Day, so May 1977.
Right.
The album came out in August.
Okay, well, confirm it, even though we don't really have to.
I know.
Jamie's answer was 1977.
Yeah. Star Wars soundtrack. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Recorded March 1977.
Really good soundtrack, by the way. Really good score. Yeah. Amazing score.
Released June 1977. So there I was you wrong. Go. I said August. It's June. But either way, guess what, mate?
You get 2 points. You're in the lead.
2 points. I'm in the lead.
All right. Let's see. Please, 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 please.
We might make this your... I think this can be your last one, dude.
Please.
So this is your last one. So you need this. You need this. Because if you don't get this right, I already win by default.
It's one of mine.
Oh, no. No.
It's Richie Kotzen's Motherhead's Family Reunion.
Oh, God.
And the worst thing is, I actually do not know when this came out. I have no clue. Because the worst thing about this is that I actually found Richie Kotzen really late. I found Richie Kotzen probably about 12 years ago. So that actually might give me a hint. I found Richie Kotzen around 12 years ago, 13 years ago, when I was still married. And
when I was still it caused the divorce. Buying it caused the divorce.
Pretty much.
I feel that, you know. If my other half bought a Richie Kotzen album, I'd get rid of him too.
I actually bought this album in JB Hi-Fi. And I was blown away because I'd known of Richie Kotzen before in other projects, but I never knew of him as a solo artist. And I literally just bought it without having heard it. You know, just on a whim, it was like $12 or whatever the hell it was. And I'm going, yeah, I'll just take that.
Yeah, yeah, $11 too much.
Jamie's got a real big hate boner for Richie. And it's just like, you know. And the minute that I begin to sound anything like Richie, he stomps his feet and bangs the walls and goes, no, stop that. So,
sure.
I'm really perplexed with this, as I said. So yeah. 13 years.
Just remember, okay, you're on 1 point, I'm on two. So if you get this wrong, guess what? It's your own fault. Literally, you can't blame me for pulling out some weird name of a hat.
I'm going to say it's the... Hang on, we're in 2020 now.
Oh, this is getting really tense because he doesn't want to have to take a shot and then a shot when he's going to lose as well. It'll be two shots, brother.
So it's going to be 2010s. All right?
Oh, okay.
It's going to be 2010s.
Okay.
And for some reason...
What's it called? Mother something, right?
Motherhead's Family Reunion.
I'll just type Motherhead. Oh, there it is. All right. I'm ready to hit enter on search to figure it out. Oh, pardon me. Oh, kaiju burps. Oh, God.
2014.
Ooh. It's tense.
2014.
Well, 1 point will draw you with me. That's a good
one
point.
1 point. So I'm pretty sure it's the 2010s.
2014. All right. Here we go. Here comes the big reveal. It's like trying to find a bloody... Here we are. Richard Kotzen discography. Motherhead's Family Reunion.
Yep.
1994.
I just saw that. I'm devastated. I'm 20 years out.
I'm sure Richie's there going like,
no. See, I've even miscounted.
Cancelling out Peter Huckinson. No, I miscounted.
Even miscounted. I was supposed to say 2004, not 2014.
Even then, you would have been out. 1994.
Exactly.
All right, take a shot. That's 0 points.
Yeah.
All right, pass it across. Even though I've already won. Let's see what this last one is. All right, and there's way more names in the hat here, so But we're not going to continue. Come on. We're running. We've done enough time already. So.
Come on. Come on.
I'm going to take this one that's kind of folded up really compact. We'll put the Brains Trust there in the trolley.
We might continue this another day. Just do it on occasion.
Bum, 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 bum. Woohoo!
Bugger. Woohoo! Bugger. Woo-hoo! Bugger.
Second Wind Herb Alpert.
Just win. Just win.
I bought this the very first band tour I went on. I've talked about this before with Musical Heroes. With the first albums I ever purchased, I think, when we talked about this. This was one of the first albums I ever purchased.
Okay.
On CD with my own money. I was like, 13 years old.
What year is it?
Well, I was in high school, so it's definitely before 2000.
Yep.
It's in the 90s, and I was 13. But, like, had it already been released for a couple of years before that, so, oh, God. So it's probably take five from there, so that'd be 1995, so it could be 96, 94... I'm going to say 1994. Well, no, I don't think I'd started high school then. I'm going to say 96. 96.
96. Oh, okay, off you go. I completely messed up the last one. That was just a complete mess up on my part.
All right. Second Wind. I'd recommend this album. I think it's a great, like, modern kind of poppy jazz. That's where that My Funny Valentine I like that, okay, that cool. You like as
yep,
well.
Yep.
And Herb Alpert he just released his big documentary too that I think was on Amazon. You can cool. still get Amazon Prime, I think. All right.
Press the button.
1996.
There you go. 2 points.
2 points.
You win. Well
Jamie,
done.
With the wind. With the win.
So what was your final tally?
My final tally was 4 points. Like, you know, I sucked at the start, but I came home strong with Star Wars and Second Wind.
Yeah, those two albums were really unfair to you.
The only point you got was for one of your ones, Level 42.
To World Machine.
I have to laugh.
And I completely missed on Richie Kotzen. Like, completely.
So out of the five that you had to do, two of them were what you should have got points for because they were yours. So you failed on Richie Kotzen. From my one, I had three of mine. I failed on Headhunters. Badly. But either way, that's where we're at. So, speaking of artists.
Oh, yeah. I like this.
Let's feature an indie artist.
Yeah, I actually forgot how to pronounce the name, so can you give it to me, please? King Cora. King Cora, and I think you actually have a connection with King Cora.
Yes. She used to be known as Elsie in the Vibes.
But she's gone into this sort of like, well, this song at least is
way more modern.
Moving into that modern sort of neo-soul, sort of a little bit on the minimalistic side, but really good vocal arrangement, really good melody. Yeah, it's just a really nice song.
It's nice, don't you? And coming into summer, it's definitely like a summer chillax.
Totally.
It's brilliant, all right? So here we go.
She's got a great voice too. So it's King Cora.
King Cora, You Got Me.
Second guess.
And when all the lights are broken, you leave the fire going. And when all the nights feel like they're closing in, you keep it an opening and show.
Back with the 13th bar. That was cool. I'm liking King Cora.
You know, that's the kind of song you want to listen to while you're drinking Kaiju Crush Beer.
Kaiju Crush Beer sponsor and King Cora.
Sponsor, not a sponsor.
Sponsor, not a sponsor. Please have a sponsor. King Cora was really cool. And the video's awesome too. If you can, go check out the video. It's a very cool video. Very cool song.
Very yellow.
Very yellow.
Lots of yellow.
Lots of yellow.
Mellow yellow.
They call it Mellow Yellow.
Oh, that's Caramello Sorry. Koala. Jeez, it's I'm getting my kid mixed up with me.
No, Mellow Yellow is the drug. Caramello Koala is the
Well, Mellow Yellow was the soft drink of the 80s.
Well, it also used to be...
It was the drug of the 60s.
It was hashish. It was actually a brand
that's
of
right.
hashish.
Yeah, that's right.
I can't believe we've gone back to there. but no, King Cora's great. I actually really like that. And... I really liked our topic of today, even though I failed miserably at it.
I think we'll have to keep this Music Shots game going. We probably won't do 10 albums we love. We'll do something else. You know?
Something else.
It'll be like, I don't know, we might pick like top 10 rock albums.
Exactly.
And throw them in the mix of all time. You know, we'll go trawling through and, you know, whatever, you know, most streamed songs of 10 years or something like, probably genres, because we want to guess the year. You want to
exactly.
guess the year it's released. So.
Exactly.
You know, or we might pick an artist.
Might do.
And be like, you know, like Burt Bacharach. That'd be, and you've got to get the year. That's going to be tough.
I can't do it.
Like 20 albums over the space of 40 years.
Wouldn't even begin. It'd be like, I might as well be throwing in a dartboard. Which was kind of like today.
That's right. Just like, you know, darts are unsafe with us at the best of times, let alone when we're hungover.
Yeah.
So we may as well make music shots.
Sounds like a plan. Sounds like a plan. It's been a lot of fun, people. I've had a blast. Have you had a blast?
I've had a kaiju.
You've had a kaiju blast.
I've had a kaiju blast. Jeez, that actually sounds a bit wrong. It sounds like Godzilla farted in my face.
I'm going to... Wow. I got a visual there that's not going to leave me in a very
kaiju
long time.
Blast.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Well, on that kaiju blast note, I'm Pete Hatchell. This is...
JR.
Have a really good night. Have a really good time. And until next time, we're the 13th Bar. Catch.